peoples, cultures, nations, and tribes. Israelites received statutes and laws directly from God Himself. God's laws are the way of life to manifest His purpose and grace. It's very important to know the culture and customs of the Jewish people, since the New Testament is filled with the signs and symbols from the Old Testament. The seven feasts of the law shows God's salvation plan for humans from the sins of the world and transform them to be the sons of God through Yeshua HaMashiach. All the seven feasts act as a roadmap to the upcoming millennial kingdom of the Lord Yeshua on the earth. So let no one judge you in food or in drink, or regarding a festival or a new moon or Sabbaths, which are a shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. Let's take an adventurous ride to explore the mysteries of the signs and symbols that indicates Yeshua HaMashiach in the seven feasts of the Lord.
Hi, and welcome to this new documentary series. This program is all about the Feast of the Lord. In Old Testament, God has given seven feasts to be celebrated by Israelites. These feasts are not only about the remembrance of the past, but it also resembles the present and reveals the future. Through this program, we would come to know the birth of the feast and the purpose of this feast and what it reveals to the world.
Time is a great factor in the world today. Everything is perfectly pre-planned using the calendar. From world leaders to a layman, every hour of the day is neatly planned. Benjamin Franklin quoted a famous saying, "You may delay, but time will not." The moment we rise from the bed, every one of us would look for a clock and a calendar to know the time and the date. Have you ever wondered how the people who lived in those days managed to know the minute, hour, day, month, and year without the devices we have today? Do you know why a day has 24 hours and why a week has only 7 days? And do you also know how a month is calculated? Do you know how they knew when 1 year was over? Stay tuned to know everything. You'll be surprised to see many facts relating to the past, present, and the future of the world. Thing to know is that all the seven feasts of the Lord have an end time meaning and fulfillment. When asked what day today, we would look at the calendar and tell the date, month, and the year. The global calendar which we use today is the Gregorian calendar, in which days and months are calculated based on the rotation of the sun. Therefore, it is also called solar calendar. The Gregorian calendar is the most widely used civil calendar. It is named after Pope Gregory XIII, who introduced it in 1582. Before that, every culture and community had its own calendar. All these calendars have their own beginning of the months, festivals, and years. Myths of every culture say that the earth has its beginning. If there is a beginning, then there should be a calendar. which has the correct calculation of days, months, and the years from the beginning. How can we find out the correct calendar from all these calendars? Amongst these calendars, there is one calendar that has calculated the days and years from the creation of the world. The days, weeks, and the months fall exactly in place. It is none other than the Hebrew calendar.
To discuss about the Feast of the Lord, we are going to meet a wonderful person, an author, a songwriter, and a Bible teacher. She is also a good researcher and writes and teaches about Israel and Feast of the Lord. She is also a worshipper and intimacy with Jesus. Come on, let's go and meet her. Hi, ma'am. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Maria. I'm so happy to be with you.
We are just going to talk about the Feast of the Lord to the Jewish people and also for the Christians all around the world.
I'd love to talk about the feast with you.
Thank you. Shall we ask the first question?
Of course.
Yeah. So how is the Jewish calendar different from current global calendar?
Well, the Jewish people have their own calendar because God decided certain times of the year that were important to him. And so back at the time of Moses, the Lord established certain times on the year that he wanted on his calendar. Okay. If you look at the calendars of all the nations, what you're calling the current global calendar, every nation has times that they feel are important, like they might be the birthday of a president, or remembering the fallen soldiers in a war in history, or even some calendars, it's the birthday of their gods. So every nation marks what they think is important on their calendar, but what really is important is what our Creator God said are the important times and seasons on His calendar. And so the Jewish people have faithfully represented God's calendar all through these thousands of years.
God created the two great lights, the sun and the moon, for signs and seasons and for days and years. The Hebrew calendar is based on the rotation of the moon and the seasons. According to rabbinic tradition, the very first commandment given to the children of Israel after being delivered from Egypt was to sanctify the new moon, thereby causing the fledgling nation to depart from the solar tradition of the Egyptians' Ra worship and to look onto the moon for a new means of reckoning time and seasons.
Is the current Jewish calendar the same as in the time of Moses?
Yes, I would say that the calendar that the modern Jewish people use is very, very similar to what was done in the time of Moses. However, certain extra things have been added in over the years because there have been events in history that were so dynamic to the Jewish survival. For example, there were enemies that rose up to destroy us and God would miraculously save us. So they became new holidays. For example, the Feast of Purim, where God delivered us from Haman and the Persian Empire in the book of Esther. That's like something that was added on later. But for the most part, I would say it really is the same calendar.
In Hebrew calendar, the hour is calculated by taking the total time of daylight from sunrise until sunset of a particular day and dividing it into 12 equal parts. The first hour of the day begins at 6 a.m. in the dawn, third hour at 9 a.m., sixth hour at 12 p.m., ninth hour at 3 p.m., and the day ends in the 12th hour at 6 p.m. in the twilight. And the night is divided into four equal parts. From 6 p.m. in the evening to 9 p.m., it is called as first watch. From 9 p.m. to 12 a.m., second watch. From 12 a.m. to 3 a.m., third watch. And from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m., fourth watch. People from all around the world would wake up to hear the clock strike at 12 to celebrate the new year. So it means that our 24-hour day begins at 12 a.m. But in Hebrew calendar, a day begins from sunset. In Hebrew, day is called Yom. The Hebrew Yom begins at sundown when three stars become visible in the sky. For instance, Sunday begins when sun sets on Saturday, and Monday begins when sun sets on Sunday. To explain further, the day begins at sunset based on the description of God's activity in creation, and the evening and the morning were the first day. The reason why a day begins in darkness is that in creation there was darkness before light was created. So, a day begins in darkness followed by the daylight, reminding us of God's creation of light. Coming back to the Hebrew calendar has 7 days per week. Prophet Moses instituted this officially to the Israelites. Moses traced it from the first man on planet Earth, Adam. Jews celebrate every seventh day of the week as a holy day of rest from their work in remembrance of the creation. Whoever follows the 7 days a week calendar is acknowledging God Almighty, the creator of the universe.
Who invented Jewish calendar?
Well, honestly, I believe the Lord is the creator of that calendar.
Okay.
If you want to think in a human terms, in the second century AD, the Jewish rabbis worked very hard to create a calendar where they calculated the solar rotations and the moon's rotations, and they created a very mathematical calendar that allowed the seasons to line up with the feasts. Okay. And that's a little bit complicated, but really I would say God is the author of that calendar.
But the names of the days of the week, which we know today, have its origin from ancient European pagan gods, and each day was dedicated to 7 planets. Same way, the 12 months of the year got their names from different sources. In Hebrew calendar, there are no specific names for the days of the week. Each day is called by the number of the day in Hebrew. The Hebrew word for first is Rishon. From this, the name of the first day is derived as Yom Rishon, second day as Yom Sheni, third day Yom Shlishi, fourth day Yom Revi, fifth day Yom Shamshi, sixth day Yom Shishi, and the last day of the week is called as Yom Shabbat. The duration of a Hebrew month is measured by the amount of time it takes for the moon to go through a lunar cycle, which is about 29.5 days. There is also an indication that there were 12 months in the annual cycle in the scriptures. Solomon had 12 governors over all Israel, who provided food for the king and his household. Each one made provision for 1 month of the year. In ancient times, similar to names of weekdays, the months had no names. They were simply called by numbers, like first month, second month, etc. But there were only 4 names of the months mentioned in the Bible. These months were very special. Abib, the first month. Ziv, the second month. Etanim, the seventh month. And Bul, the eighth month. The present names of the months of the Jewish calendar were adopted from the Babylonian exile. These names are mostly Babylonian names. The solar year is 365 days long, but a moon year is only 354 days. If we would compare both of it, we would get a difference of 11 days. Therefore, an extra month is added to the Hebrew calendar every 2 or 3 years. They do this so that the seasons and the day of celebrating the feasts would fall in line. The Hebrew calendar year conventionally begins on Rosh Hashanah, the anniversary of the creation of Adam and Eve. But when God brought the Israelites out of Egypt from the iron clutches of Pharaoh, God changed the first month from Ethanim to Abib and said, "This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you." But before that, Ethanim was the first month of the year. This was practiced from Adam to Noah until Moses. Until the division of the United Kingdom of Israel from Dan to Beersheba, Abib was counted as the first month. After the division, the ancient northern kingdom of Israel counted years using the ecclesiastical new year starting on Abib 1, while the southern kingdom of Judah counted years using the civil new year starting on Ethanim 1.
Are the two calendars, a religious and civil calendar, is followed by Jewish today?
Yes, if the Jewish people are living among other nations and not in the land of Israel, then they have to follow in their workplace, in their everyday life, they have to follow the civil calendar of whether it's America or France or India. But if we live in Israel, really the Jewish calendar and the Israeli civil calendar are combined so that we can combine our spiritual life with our everyday life. So only in Israel are they the same?
God has specific purpose for the changing of the first month. He didn't just stop with the change. He instituted the seven feasts to be observed forever. These are not just holidays, but holy days. In fact, the word holiday was derived from the words holy days. These seven feasts of the Lord has passed, present and future prophetic meaning. It was on the top of Mount Sinai that God gave Moses the dates and observances of the seven feasts of the Lord, which are the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of First Fruits, the Feast of Pentecost, the Feast of Trumpets, the Feast of Day of Atonement, the Feast of Tabernacles. Leviticus chapter 23 is the single chapter from the entire Bible that sums up everything. These are the set times of the Lord, the sacred occasions which you shall celebrate each at its appointed time. It is interesting to know the Hebrew word for feast is moed, which more literally translated mean divine appointments. And more importantly, all seven feasts point to and are fulfilled in the Lord Yeshua. These feasts are separated into two seasons, the spring feast and the fall feast. The first three feasts, Pesach, Unleavened Bread, and First Fruits, fall in March and April. The fourth one, Shavuot, marks the summer harvest and falls in late May or early June. These four feasts are called spring feasts.
So why are the four feasts, the first four feasts, referred to as a spring feast?
Well, the first four feasts are Passover, Unleavened Bread, First Fruits, and Pentecost, which in Hebrew is called weeks or Shavuot. They're the four spring feasts because they come in the spring months of the Hebrew calendar.
Okay.
Now, in an English calendar, that would be about the month of April for the first three, and then it would be about early June for the fourth one. But on the Hebrew calendar, they come in the springtime of the year when the spring crops are coming up.
The first feast is the Passover or Pesach. Passover is called the Feast of Salvation, which is celebrated on the 14th day of the first month at twilight. The second feast is the Unleavened Bread, Shuk Hamotzi. The Feast of Unleavened Bread is celebrated on the next day to Passover, that is on the 15th day of the first month. It is celebrated for 7 days. The first and the seventh day of the feast are holy gathering days where no work is to be done.
Is there any Sabbath other than the seventh day Sabbath rest?
Well, the main Sabbath, or Shabbat, as we call it in Hebrew.
In Hebrew.
The main Shabbat is every 7 days. Okay. On a normal calendar, we would call that Saturday, but the Jewish people say Shabbat. Okay. But in addition to those regular every 7 day Sabbaths, there are special Sabbaths that we call the Feasts of the Lord, where we do no ordinary work. Now, they might fall on a Saturday in some years, but normally they will just fall on a different day every year. Mm-hmm. Always the same day on the Hebrew calendar, but a different day on the Roman calendar. And so they would also be called a special Shabbat.
The third feast is the first fruits, Reshit Katzir. The Feast of the First Fruits is celebrated on the day next to Sabbath and the Passover week. The fourth feast is Pentecost, Shavuot. 7 weeks from the Feast of First Fruits is the Shavuot, which means Feast of Weeks. It is celebrated on the 50th day from First Fruits, and that is why this is called as Pentecost. The last three feasts, Trumpets, Yom Kippur, and Sukkot, falls in September and October. These are called as fall feasts.
Can you explain about the fall feast?
Okay. The three fall feasts are the Yom Teruah, the blowing of the trumpet, the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Tabernacles, which is also called the ingathering of the harvest.
Okay.
And they come in the what we call the fall season. In America and in Israel, we have a season in the fall, which is between the summer and the winter. And that's when the final summer harvest, the late ripening grapes and the olives and the fruits, come in at the end of the year. So we call them the fall feasts.
Okay.
The first fall feast is the Feast of Trumpets, or Rosh Hashanah. The Feast of Trumpets fall in September and occurs on the first day of the seventh month in the Hebrew calendar. The sixth feast is the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. The Day of Atonement is the Day of Confession, the highest of holy days. This occurs on the 10th day of the 7th month. The 7th feast is the Tabernacles, or Sukkot. Feast of Tabernacles is celebrated on the 15th day of the 7th month. This is a 7-day feast.
You are the Feast of First Fruit, the Feast of Weeks, and Feast of Tabernacle, related to barley harvest, wheat harvest, and grape harvest, respectively?
In the Israeli agriculture, because Maria, you have to remember that all the feasts on the Lord's calendar are about agricultural times of the year.
Yeah.
And so, to answer your question, the early spring feasts are about the barley harvest.
Okay.
The barley was the first grain to come up very early in the spring, in April.
Yeah.
And then about 50 days later was the wheat harvest, when the wheat would become ripe. And then the Feast of Pentecost relates to the wheat harvest. And then you have a long summer, and the fruits are beginning to ripen. The pomegranate, the grapes, the oil, and the wine. And so the Feast of Tabernacles is more about the grape harvest and the final fruits of summer.
The Jewish people have different meanings to the scripture regarding the Messiah. An often repeated concept within the tradition of Israel is that there is not one Messiah, but two.
Can the four spring feasts compare to suffering servant and the three as the conquering king?
Well, to answer that question, we have to give some background.
Yeah, please.
What you're asking is about two pictures of the Messiah.
Yeah.
That the Jewish people have identified as the suffering servant Messiah and the conquering king Messiah. And so where they get that is, if you remember Joseph, the 11th son of Jacob, in the book of Genesis, Joseph was sold by his brothers into slavery, and he suffered in prison for many, many years before God finally raised him up to be a leader next to Pharaoh. And so the Jewish people call him a suffering servant type or picture of Messiah, because he saved his people.
Okay.
After he was raised up, he saved Egypt from famine, and he saved his brothers, Jacob's sons, who became the nation of Israel. And so he became a picture of the suffering servant. And the Lord Jesus, the Lord Yeshua, was like the suffering servant in many ways. He was like Joseph. But the Jewish people saw other Bible verses that talked about a conquering king, not someone who was humble and meek and broken and bruised and pierced, But they saw this conquering king in Isaiah 63 and in many other scriptures where he came in mighty on a horse doing battle against the physical enemies of Israel. And so they saw this other picture of Messiah they called the conquering king. Mm-hmm. So to answer your question, the spring feasts paint more a picture of the suffering servant ministry. Mm-hmm. And the three fall feasts that are the final feasts are the end of the prophetic calendar, where we see him coming as a king, as we see in even Revelation 19, to come as a judge, as a warrior, as a ruler. And so the fall feasts fulfill that kingly role.
Yeah.
In his first advent, the Lord Yeshua came as our suffering servant and thereby fulfilled the meaning of the spring holidays. His second advent, he will fulfill the latent meaning of the fall holidays.
So are the feasts of the Lord a biblical pattern or shadow which are fulfilled in Messiah's period?
Oh yes, absolutely. That's a very important question. The feasts of the Lord are a picture, a prophetic picture of the ministry that Messiah would do. And each feast represents a different aspect of his ministry right up until the marriage supper of the Lamb.
Our God is neither late nor early, but does things on time. Throughout the Bible, we can see God being very particular about times and seasons. He has revealed everything that he purposed to do to his servants, the prophets, but never the time. This is as well applicable to the timing of our Yeshua HaMashiach's coming. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. If Yeshua HaMashiach comes today, are you ready to meet him?
Through this episode, we have come to know about the Hebrew calendar and also about the date and time and how they are calculated. Now, you also know the names of the feast of the Lord and when they are celebrated. God, our Heavenly Father, gave these feasts to the Jews to be celebrated for a purpose. Each and every feast of the Lord ends up with the hope of the coming of Messiah. All the seven feasts resembles our Lord Yeshua's mission on this world as a Messiah and about the end times. The feast begins with the Lord Yeshua as a Passover lamb and ends with the Lord Yeshua as the Lion of Judah who will come again to rule the whole world forever and ever. In the following episodes, we are going to explore all the secrets and hidden images of our Lord Yeshua in the seven feasts of the Lord. This will be interesting and encouraging to get ready for his coming and also to enter into his kingdom of heaven. We'll meet you in the next episode. Till then, it's Maria signing off from you.